الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء وهو السميع العليم. بسم الله مجريها ومرساها إن ربي لغفور رحيم. والحمد لله حمدا يليق بجماله وكماله ورفعته وقدرته كريم، وتوسل إليه وأسأله بنبيه الرحيم سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يشرح لي صدري ويحلل عقدة من لساني يبقه قولي. ربي أوزعني أن أشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علي وعلى والدي وأن أعمل صالحا ترضاه واصلح لي في ذريتي إن تبت إليك وإني من المسلمين. Now I'm grateful all of you have made the journey to come to this retreat to study a subject that we are all responsible for. And the subject is to do with ourself. And the self is what makes us who we are. We could be people who can be described to be of good character, or on the other side, we could be described to be people of an evil, wicked character. And if you look at the history of the world, people are only measured in their legacy by their character. Be it good character or evil, wicked character. And therefore, in this journey, inshallah, in the next few days, we're going to talk about this. But before we start anything, we want to talk about the nafs itself, because people are confused in understanding mahiyatul nafs, or what is the nafs. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called nafs, to some it means something, to other it means something else. But in my journey, when I'm learning, all my life, I try to take the best of the explanations to make life easier for me to understand where did I come from, what is my purpose of being here, and where am I going next. And by doing that, self-questioning, to understand literally who am I and where do I fit in the huge spectrum of different qualities of different humans living on the earth. You find an atheist who is with sound character. You find a devoted religious person who is with an evil character. But yet, both are claiming different claims. And both are making different accusation. The believer will say the non-believer is going to hell, even if he is of sound character. And vice versa, the non-believer who will say, I don't really believe in anything, and therefore I'm here just to live my life and enjoy it, and he's just wasting his time. So where does the truth lie? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks a lot about the nafs in the Quran. If we only stop, ponder where the word nafs comes, it's only three letters: noon, fa, and seen. Subhanallah, nafs, and the plural is nufus or anfus. Okay, so one of us has a nafs, and many of us have nufus or anfus. Together, we make humanity, a good one or an evil one to be remembered. In the name of Hitler, you only remember evil. In the name of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab, you only remember evil. In the name of Fir'aun, you only remember evil. In the name of the people of Salih, Qawm Salih or Qawm Hud, you only remember evil. In the name of the modern terrible groups that cause havoc on the earth, on the right or on the left of the spectrum, whether they are religious or not, you only remember evil. When people talk about those, there is something sinister in talking about them because they are seeing themselves. But on the other side, you remember people like Ibrahim alayhi salam, like Yaqub alayhi salam, like Yusuf alayhi salam, the most noblest in forgiving, like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You remember people like Salah ad-Din al-Ayyubi, a Kurdish man. The Arabs think he is Arab, and the Kurds, many of them, they don't know who he is. A proud man who did a lot of good. Even in your modern history of Britain, his treatment to Salah, to the King of England, it's amazing. Yani, to see, this is a man who understood what faith is all about. A man is down from his horse, he could kill him. But he said, give him a horse. Why? Because he has the good character. His nafs was a sound nafs. And there are many other men I can mention and names who did a fantastic job in this world, in different fields. But on the other side, there are groups of people who did good. The companions of Medina, the Ansar, who shared everything. Their legacy is of good character. And you go on and find others after them. Even recently, in Britain, I have seen a lot of groups of people traveling to save the suffering people of Bosnia, bringing them to England, giving them home, then with Syria, with the Somali little youth. And really, there is a lot of good. If the nafs can become that which possesses the good. Otherwise, it will be the opposite. What is this nafs? Now, I hear a lot of people talking about it, and I find a lot of books talking about it, and I'm not really here to talk about what I read, what I was taught, but I'm here to talk about what I have experienced. Because we are not allowed to speak and give knowledge only from our experience. So you hear me always telling stories about myself, about the journey I went through, because that's the way I was taught. Don't teach anything you have not experienced. How could you? And a man who's single advising somebody who's getting married. Does it make sense? Have you got married? No. Have you ever lived with a married person? Well, I accepted to my mother and father and they were always arguing. No. So does it make sense? So what kind of advice that person give? It doesn't make sense. So you need to think about it. But what I have experienced from the knowledge I have learned with the people whom I went with in this journey, they said the nafs and the ruh are totally separate things. In the writing that I have read when I was taught, the only man who says this clearly is Imam al-Ghazali. Said your ruh is not your nafs, and your nafs is not your ruh. They are totally different, independent bodies. And the physical body, which you think you are when you look at the mirror, is not really you. It is the carrier that carries you. Who are you? You are the ruh. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib says clearly, teaching his companion, okay? Do not busy yourself and trouble yourself by working hard to look after your body or to care for your nafs, for you are neither by the body or the nafs, the human being you are supposed to be, only by the spirit, the ruh, you are a human being. فَأَنْتَ بِالْرُوحِ لَا بِالْجِسْمِ إِنْسَانُ. Okay, so he made it clear for us to understand. The jism, the body, is your vehicle, so you can transplant our body to somebody else. Doesn't matter. If it is needed and it is allowed, we can do it. Neither my heart can benefit somebody else to become me, nor their heart will benefit me in any way, or if any part of the body transplanted, because this is just a vehicle. مِنَ التُرَابُ إِلَى التُرَابُ from the dust to the dust it will return. And the ruh, each ruh is independent. Each one of us, his ruh is himself. No two arwah are the same. So you are an independent creature of God, being given the responsibility to live on this earth, to run the duration of time granted to you by living the test. What test? Allah says, إِنَّا خَلَغْنَاكُمْ لِنَبْلُوَكُمْ. Indeed, we created you to test you spiritually. So we were in the heaven as spirits. We were brought down onto the earth, given physical bodies through the coming together for parents in marriage. And we are here to be tested. So it is wrong to look at your body and to criticize it. Because this is Allah's gift to you. Whether you are short or tall, big or small, dark in color or light, having a problem in the creation of the body or not, doesn't matter. You accept it. The Prophet used to look at himself in the mirror and say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi hassana khalqi kama hassana khuluqi. Praise be to Allah, the one who has perfected my creation in physical form as he perfected my character. Allahumma hassin khulqi. Oh Allah, perfect my character. Oh Allah, perfect my character. So the whole thing about building the character, because the nafs is watching. And in England, they have learned, people look at the mirror and see a mirror, mirror on the wall. Who is the most handsome of them all? Most attractive. So we are buying, and the magazine and the television program are telling us, you see, and it's all nonsense. You are going to die, you see, and you're going to mess up your life. What's the nafs then? I know who I am. I'm the spirit, I'm a ruh. And the body is my vehicle. But what's the nafs? The nafs is the combination of your desire and an inclination coming in a body Allah puts into you, blown into your body after 120 days of your creation. When the ruh comes down, the body has to be there, ready. So the body needs to desire. Initially, when the body is built within the womb of the mother, it is nourished by the mother itself. And every inclination comes from her. But after 120 days, and the nafs is put in, and the ruh is blown in, you are there in a vehicle which is your own. It has its own feelings. And the mother will begin to feel a different vibe inside, a child kicking, a child upset and angry now because he's feeling. Before that, he doesn't. No kicking, no screaming and shouting and saying, feed me. For goodness sake, you are eating the wrong food. Eat the right food. You're killing me. They do. I promise you, they do inside. But we don't know. And therefore, you can talk to the child. And they listen and they hear. Wallahi, I have seen a child, 6 years old. He answered every question a person in front of me asked him from the Quran. 6 years old. When I asked his parents, how can he be like that? They said, shocking, even we don't understand, because the mother said to me, when he was in my stomach and I was carrying him, I was regularly reading for him, not for me, Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk, Surah al-mulk. This, I love it and I read it for him. And in this surah, subhanallah, Tabarak alladhi, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk, wahu ala kulli shayin khad, alladhi khalaqa al-mawta wal-hayata liyabluwakum, ayyukum ahsan. The one who created death and life to test you. She said, the first test I had, the moment he uttered his first word, he looked at me and said, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. She just started crying, properly, first word. Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk wa huwa ala. He knows all the Quran by heart. No teachers. Who taught? What a beautiful mother. You all wish your mother did that to you. Rather than sitting there arguing with your dad, or arguing about the home they live in, or fighting and pushing and shoving, and then you come out angry and upset. So they say, you are the way your parents raised you before you are born. You are hearing everything. I'm telling you, if you are a parent or you are about to have children, be very careful. When you are 6, 7 months old, the child knows everything. You come out and say, Laha, pull the other one. You want me to be kind? You should have been kind to my mother, dad. But he will not say it to you in that one. In the modern day, maybe he can stand and say it to you because we are living in a different world. So your nafs is the home of your inclination, of your desires, for good or for bad. You desire to do good things, then you desire to do bad things. And both are being implanted within this nafs as the program. Allah programmed it. And he said it clearly in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. And every nafs of every individual, Allah himself brought it forth and put it in the way it is supposed to be within you and taught it right from wrong. فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. Allah has given your nafs all the right things to do and all the wrong things to avoid, and you know everything. As a child, as a youth, young man or woman, or an adult or an old man or woman, you know everything. You know, we all know. None of us will wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to work today. I really need to show the beauty of my body and walk without clothes. You don't do that. I challenge you, you will never do that. You will not be able to. Why? What stops you from doing it? You see? You know. Your nafs knows it's not correct. You see? You stand up in the train and in front of everybody and pick the first person and say, excuse me, I just want to enjoy myself, and you slap them. This is a daring thing. You can't do that. You see? They say there are two men who are walking together, and one of them saw a man that he liked his head. His head was shining bald. He said, it's so beautiful, I would love to slap it. His friend said to him, I dare you do that. He said, what would you give me? He promised him something. So he went behind the man and slapped him. The man turned around and angry. I thought you were my friend, so and so. I'm so sorry. And I slapped you for this reason. He gave an excuse. He didn't say, I felt like doing it. Because you will not be able to. Because you know exactly what is going to come back. Exactly. You will receive the same or worse. Or even you could be called to be asked in front of a judge, why did you attack somebody? And this is haram in Islam to do that. Anyway, so the nafs knows. And the nafs is very coward, by the way. Absolutely coward. And the fear we have, Allahu Akbar, is unimaginable. And we, in spirituality, we try to teach people to be courageous. A spiritual person is not a coward. Because you are always the truth. You never do the wrong. So why should you be frightened? Because we are always frightened to lose. Yeah? You are frightened to lose, so you fall into the trap of your nafs. Then Allah said in the Quran, in Surah Al-Shamsi wa Duhaha, very beautiful surah, in Sapara Amma, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا وَالْلَّيْلِ إِذَا يَخْشَهَا. And then he comes and talks about the nafs. Okay? وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Successful is the one, while living their duration of lifetime, is able to remove from his nafs all the ill qualities, all the evil traits, all the wicked habits. Okay? And built it with the best qualities, make it to be a good nafs. وَقَدْ خَلْوَا دَسَّاهَا. And a failure, a doomed one, who just cover his mistakes and say, it doesn't matter, I can carry on. Okay, and we'll talk about this, okay, maybe in the other half of the lesson. But then you have to remember, the nafs dies. There come a time the nafs is no longer there. But we know, الأرواح جنود مجندة, the ruhs, they don't die. Every ruh is alive. Somebody will say, Astaghfirullah. You are a human being, you are nafs, you are soul, everything. When you die, you die. You finish. Like some people who don't understand. One man came across to me and said to me, you always talk about this, but people go to the grave, they are just dead, finished. Neither benefit you, neither benefit themselves. Your visit to them is valueless. I looked at him and said to him, are you a Muslim? He said, of course I am. Otherwise, I'm not talking to you like that. I said to him, didn't you forget one fact? Your messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you follow and you claim to follow his sunnah, encouraged us to visit the grave. Indeed, I have forbidden you from visiting them. Ala fazuruha. From today, continuously keep visiting the grave. Why should he advise us to visit a place where there is no benefit in? Neither for the deceased nor for ourselves. He said, oh, just to make dua for them. Just make dua for them. What benefit they will get from that? But because the Prophet says so. Okay, before I make my dua, why do I say, Assalamu alaikum ahal al-qubur? Salam be to you, people of the grave. If they cannot hear me, if they cannot listen to me. He was stunned. He was just, couldn't speak. But I said, no buts, my brother. You understand not the message of your messenger whom you claim to be devoted to his sunnah, and you are trying to correct me. Go and learn and then come back to me. If you can come and tell me and negate this hadith and say it is not valid, or the salam that I will say has no value to them, then I'm wasting my time. And it's not from the messenger, because the messenger will never teach me something, will not be bringing me benefits. وَإِنَّهُ لَا يَنْطُقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. For it is he, Muhammad, صلى الله عليه وسلم, who does not speak of his mind or his desire and inclination, only it is an inspiration from Allah to him to utter it to me to benefit from, to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I said, this is only the beginning. Can I go further? He was a little bit wanting to run away. I said, wait. Didn't you hear after the battle of Uhud, the messenger, peace be upon him, went to the grave and he spoke to the people who have been killed among the Muslims and the non-Muslims. He said, turn to the people who are non-Muslims, said, okay, هَلْ وَيَتْتُمْ مَا وَعَدَ رَبُّكُمْ حَقًّا. Did you find what your Lord promised you to be true? The companion said, Ya Rasulullah, can they hear you? And in any case, they're kuffar. They're just useless commodities, like any other product. Finished, dead. He said, Wallahi, by Allah Almighty God, they hear me as you hear me, and I hear them as I hear you, but you don't. In this, you should underline it. But you don't. You are not yet ready to hear them. You are not ready yet for them, okay, to understand everything you say, but I can. So that means all of us, we can hear the dead when they speak, be they Muslim or not. Today I am astonished. In England, an Englishman, a Welshman, Irishman, okay, a Scottishman, whether they believe or not, they take good responsibility of visiting their deceased in their graves. They clean the grave, they water it, they put flower, they plant. And we who think we know everything, they, oh, they're just wasting their time. Nothing there. And the worst of us say, they're kuffar, they're just going to hell. Allahu Akbar, you are putting yourself on the seat of God. And you are making the judgment before the day of judgment. And you are judging yourself to be better because your nafs is bigger. You are like shaitan the day when Allah commanded the malaika to prostrate to Adam. When your Lord said to the malaika, prostrate to Adam, فسجدوا. They all adhered, the malaika. Illa, except Iblis. Aba was takbar. He refused and behaved with arrogance. When you do such a thing, when you are judgmental, when you see yourself better and bigger and more exalted and others are worse than you and nothing and they are just like one of them, says once, when they ask him, why do you criticize the Hindus and the Jews and the Sikhs and in your tape? He said, oh, I don't do that. Speaking about Allah, representing Rasulullah in the wrong way, which your nafs declared to be the truth, but not Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yeah? So this is from the real life that I lived. Be careful. Don't judge people. For Allah doesn't look into the figure.